We also have the interim director of the Human Services Department tonight, Jason Johnson, and if you don't mind coming up. We're going to have a conversation about homelessness in Highland Park. He's going to give a few brief remarks, and then we'll open up the floor to questions, if that's okay. And so any homelessness-related questions that you've been saving all night, you're welcome to ask them during this period. And the meeting closes at 8, so we might have to rush this a little bit. I don't know if you can stay around a few minutes, but we don't want to waste too much of your time. So, it's funny.
Thank you. Thanks. I'm going to keep my opening remarks short so that I can instead, with my colleagues from the city who are here, respond to your questions. So again, as a point of introduction, my name is Jason Johnson. I'm interim director of the Human Services Department. This is better?
Yeah.
All right. And I'm also your neighbor. I live just west of the Home Depot down the hill. And it's good to be here. I've been in this space for evening yoga, but it's good to be here as part of this community. I am, you know, the Human Services Department does many things. It is our charge to help the most vulnerable in the city. We support young people, we support people as they age. We hope that we support them aging in place so that they can stay out of expensive institutions. We are the agency that leads the mayor's office on domestic violence and sexual assault. We also are the contract holder, the partner with King County on public health. We have a number of programs that help support affordability and livability in the city, and we are where most of the investments, especially those investments that go back out to community-based organizations to address homelessness, are administered in our department. Our department is primarily a funder. But we do a lot of convening, we do a lot of bringing people together, trying to hear ideas and develop new programs, improve programs that currently exist. We're also a direct service provider. So we have direct services that support people as they age. We support people living with disabilities throughout the county. We also have a team of individuals who administer the utility discount program citywide for Seattle Public Utilities and City Light. We also, just this year, house the navigation team that I know you've heard a lot about, and I'm really thankful that Jackie is here from that team, as well as Fred. And I mention all of that. I think it's important to sort of know that the city is doing its best to serve a wide and varied and very diverse group of people in need. We do all of this through a racial equity lens. Racial equity and addressing racism is core to who we all are as city departments, but it's especially an important and really critical foundational part of the work in the Human Services Department. I also wanted to, where's Lisa? There she is. Lisa Gustavson is a planner in the department and is really a planner focused primarily on our crisis response. Those are some of our outreach efforts as well as the tiny villages or sanctioned encampments. We have eight of those throughout the city, one here along Myers Way. And she has a couple of handouts that I just wanted to make sure people have access to. One is the mayor did a great job highlighting her budget priorities. And one of those budget priorities that she mentioned was homelessness and housing affordability. So what Lisa's distributing is a fact sheet on 2019, some of the changes that are in the mayor's proposed budget for next year to support addressing homelessness citywide, as well as to support increased affordability in housing. The other document is I brought because it's a question I get most often. You mentioned how confusing some of this service access can be for individuals experiencing homelessness. And the department this year tried to create a visual aid to show what the homeless response system looks like. And it's a pretty elementary drawing, but I think it offers insight into both sort of where the homeless investments live, as well as what the sort of journey that an individual experiencing homelessness takes to get into permanent housing. It starts with prevention. We want to do everything we can to make sure that we can stop someone from experiencing homelessness at all. So we have nearly $7 million invested in prevention efforts out of the Human Services Department to keep people housed. That mostly is rental assistance. When people have a crisis in their life, they're facing eviction, there are prevention efforts that can help keep them housed. If that doesn't work, we also have almost $3 million in what we call diversion. It's client assistance money that can be offered to an individual or a family one time to help them through a crisis. So they are, hopefully just day one, day two of experiencing homelessness. And it is someone who can meet with them and has a resource, a cash resource, that can help them get back to a home community where they have natural supports, get them back into a unit, paying the first and last month's rent, help them finish a certificate so they can either get employed or remain employed. So it's first we start to prevent and keep people in their homes. If that can't work, we have something we refer to as diversion to get them immediately housed. And then the bulk of our investments, out of the Human Services Department, we have just over $60 million that we invest annually. And about $30 million of that supports our crisis response system. Those are shelters. Those are the tiny home villages. These are street outreach and transitional housing, hygiene centers, meal programs. These are the basic survival supports services that individuals living unsheltered rely on. And so that's where the bulk of the Human Services Department's investments sit. But ultimately, and what we're driving toward every single day in partnership with community-based organizations, is an effort to get people housed. And so we also have a number of housing investments. We invest in voucher programs. We invest in services attached to sort of brick-and-mortar homes that the city helps to build with community-based organizations. We also have some programs that can buy down rents or make rental units in the private market more affordable. And we can do that on a short-term basis or on an ongoing basis. So I just wanted to sort of highlight the homeless service system and also bring that document to hopefully make a little more clear what that service delivery system looks like.
We'll open up the floor to questions.
I'm just going to start. So Highland Park has been hosting homeless encampments for 10 years now, with Nicholsville 1, 2, and 2.5, or 3.0, now Camp Second Chance, plus the RV staging. And we are not seeing the resources around navigation teams to match the investment and the work that we've done as a neighborhood to host these encampments. I've had a woman living on, two women on my street who have been homeless for 3 years now. I've called the police, other folks, and she's still there. She's not the only one, but we have people living in the different, on the streets, because we've been hosting these encampments. And so I think our ask as a neighborhood is to put some investment into having more navigation teams come through this area, because we do have the green belt, we have Riverview. We have places where every few months you have folks having to come in and clean out big areas of encampments. And you live around here, other folks live around here, you know this. And so I think it's just responsible for the city to put some investment, and we've been asking for this for quite a while.
Right, so I think that I kind of heard two questions in your comments. One, we are doing more outreach than we have in the past. and the mayor's 2019 budget increases that outreach effort. It's expanding the navigation team. Likewise, it is expanding outreach efforts in some targeted communities around downtown. So it's in Capitol Hill, First Hill, and the Chinatown International District. We also just, in 2018, for the first time, invested in a wide array of outreach teams and are trying to better connect all of those teams. So we have some teams that might focus on a particular population, a target population, or they may serve a specific geography. And what we're trying to do with the Human Services Department is better connect all of those outreach teams so that they can work together to serve the city in a better way. The second part of your question, I think the more important part, is maybe around prioritization. You say you've reached out to the navigation team and are feeling like there hasn't been a response.
Yeah, I mean, someone said we don't want to work after 5 o'clock. like things like that. I mean, when George was in his position, myself and Marianne, who was just left, we actually had to drive around to show him because he wasn't sure. So we individuals have done a lot of work to support, you know, the city. And I think the reality is that whether Nicholsville was sanctioned or not, the fact is that this neighborhood, this particular neighborhood, has been hosting encampments for 10 years.
And in fact, they've never left down there. Even though downhill, I would it may not be considered Highland Park, it is the gateway to our community. We all funnel in and out of there, and it has never left.
And so when we made a request for some reciprocal resources when Camp Second Chance is being sanctioned for neighborhood, not just about how the camp is run, but how the city is going to work with the neighborhood around that. And I've presented it to city council, I've sent it to a million people, and never gotten a response. And so I think as a neighborhood that's been holding this, and I know other city neighborhoods are, but one that, you know, it took the companies at the end of the block to sue the city to finally get proposal to move.
Yeah, I hear you. And it's an ongoing challenge in this neighborhood as well as many others. That said, I think there has been a really intensive, ongoing effort to by police, by the navigation team, by the outreach workers that we contract with, along Myers Way, and I think that, you know, as difficult as both that that area, that especially that greenbelt that we were really focused on this week, it's really challenging for outreach workers to sort of get in there. Folks were pretty embedded. I think, you know, you still saw a really intentional effort by the city's outreach teams to serve that region. We can of course do better, and you know the navigation team every day, literally every morning, has to triage a variety of encampments, individuals, different crises that are existing all over the city. And I think they do that well. They have a protocol by which they prioritize certain sort of hotspots. You know, I commend their efforts. But we have thousands of people that are living outdoors in our community. We have well over 4,000 individuals on any given night that are sleeping homeless on our streets. And so I think, you know, you hear the mayor talking about this as a priority in her budget, because we are literally combating a crisis of thousands of individuals sleeping homeless on our streets.
Michelle? I have a kind of a follow-up question, and I wanted to actually ask it to the mayor because it's more of a budget-related question. But like a few years ago, there was an organization that specifically dealt with people in RVs, getting them into housing and other services. Could money be restored to that one of the programs similar to that?
Yeah, so Compass Housing had a specific Road to Housing program that did outreach to individuals living in vehicles. That program, as a program, no longer exists. But Mayor Durkin did put a new investment of $200,000 into vehicular, to support individuals living in vehicles.
But what does that mean?
Yeah, we have to figure out what that means.
Okay.
But it means that this mayor not only has heard from business leaders, business owners, as well as residents who have seen a number of RVs and residents living in their cars in their neighborhood, but she's willing to take the issue on, put some money into it. We've piloted some sort of safe lots and safe parking areas with services attached. There's one in Soto where we pay for porta potties and sort of have held a plot of land so that people can park there instead of on city streets. And so there are ideas that we're looking at up and down the West Coast. There's a promising program at Santa Monica that we may want to duplicate. But the good news is that Mayor Durkin put some money into the Human Services Department budget for 2019 so that we could respond. We saw a huge increase in the one-night count, the one-night homeless or unsheltered census that occurs every year in the number of people living in vehicles. And so it's imperative that the city respond.
Just to clarify, I just have one clarifying question on the data you presented. You said on any given night, 4,000 homeless people on the streets of Seattle. Does that include people in RVs?
It does, yeah.
Do you include them in that number?
It does, yes.
And so two more questions,
I just have a question, two rolled into one. So you gave us a number for prevention and emergency. What's the number that goes into housing programs in your chart? Like, how much housing are we building?
Yeah.
That number?
He's at 30.
And the reason I ask is, just within a 3-block radius here, we lost 28 affordable housing units this year, right? That's little homes, little crappy old homes that got ripped down that were actually affordable, you know, lower income units that were bought by investors, and now they just double the rent and everybody gets kicked out. So that's just I'm sure we're just a tiny microcosm. We're just reporting the front line you already know. But what does that housing program look like? Because that's the problem. I think that's the fundamental problem. We don't have any stock.
Yeah, there's one solution to homelessness. It's homes.
Build homes, right.
And the Office of Housing is responsible for all of the housing investments that go into building preserving housing in the city. What we fund out of the Human Services Department, what you'll see in that chart, is sometimes there needs to be services and operating to provide stability for individuals who live in that housing, and that comes out of the Human Services Department budget. And it's about a quarter of that budget, so about 25% of this, the $60 million, goes into those housing services. But citywide, and this last year, the Office of Housing put $100 million or $130 million into development of affordable housing.
What was that number? Sorry.
It's between $100 and $130 million. We all voted for a housing levy. We doubled that levy just a year ago. And those new increased investments in developing affordable housing are occurring. There will be another $100 million offered up for development of affordable housing this coming year in 19, and then again in 20. By the end of 2020, there will be over 2,400 new units of affordable housing created citywide. That is both a lot and not enough. So there's a lot more to do, which is why we're trying to get really innovative. I've heard the mayor speak many times about models in Vancouver, BC that are cheaper and quicker to set up. We are exploring what it looks like to use voucher programs in a different way. Can we buy down rent in the private market so that people can use existing units of housing that already exist at a more affordable price? So we're having to get really creative about how we create enough affordable housing in the city. Because even though with the generous housing levy that we have locally, it's not enough to keep pace and to actually combat the
So final question, and then anybody else who has questions, you might ask the director on the way out.
I live across the street from Myers Way in that very large apartment complex. So, and I've been there 9 years since the day it was built or opened. And the homeless were living there when I arrived. There's been homeless in that property for a long, long time. My point is, and I want to back up Gutter a bit, is the communications with the navigation team. Well, I appreciate very much what's gone on this week. We've waited a very long time for that property to be cleaned up. I don't think you can convince all of the 600 people who live at one address that it's going to be long-term or effective because they are very uncomfortable with cleanups that have happened before. But what I remember over all this time is the poor quality of communication in trying to contact anybody from the navigation team. And Captain Davis, wherever you disappeared to, wherever you are, you know, it's been very helpful. We get reports through him with information that's been provided to him to give to us, but the navigation team will be out here this day, this week, this month. And then I talked to him a couple weeks later, and because we pay attention to what's going on out there, and it didn't happen. And this probably 3-4 times this year?
A few times, yes.
Yeah, at least. I'll say 3, maybe not 4. But this, what happened with us, in that massive shift, you know, is what happens in Highland Park, what happens in Ballard, what happens in Fairmont, what happens everywhere. We have got to improve the communication to us, the public, with that team. You may need to increase them. Obviously, there's got to be budget money added, X, you know, YZ for all that. But we should have a direct communication to someone on that team that is responsive in a timely manner. I shouldn't have to go through my police captain to find out what's going on, for him to have to make another call to find out what's going on, to call me back to say this is going to happen and then it doesn't. So money needs to be put more into that team, and a better response effort needs to be, you know.
That was part of the request.
Yeah, thank you for raising that. Yep. Yeah. And that was detailed in the letter. I want to say there's a really, I was very intentional about who I brought with me today. So you have members of that navigation team here in the room with you today, with Fred Podesta, with Jackie. Will is here, who does a lot of communications on behalf of that team. Is responsible for making sure that our blog is live and up to date and current on the activities of the navigation team. But Fred, do you want to mention sort of specific to the Myers Way?
Thanks for being here, everybody. Again, I'm Fred Podesta with the Human Services Department. I've taken over emergency response for homelessness issues. One thing, Jason, didn't point out was that the history of the navigation team is really born in the state of emergency that was declared in the last administration, and has been an interdisciplinary team that includes the police department, includes staff in parks, in Seattle Public Utilities, and not until just within the last 6 weeks has this all actually been absorbed into the Human Services Department as a freestanding, actual discrete organizational unit. And I'm in no position to ask anybody for any patience on this issue, but that's probably led to some of the communications issues. You should not need to go through your precinct captain. And I will say, and Captain Davis, you have a great advocate for this neighborhood who has made it very clear to the navigation team how we need to prioritize what the needs of this neighborhood was, how we staged this encampment cleanup in Myers Way that's going on this week, which was a huge operation. The mayor misspoke a little bit when she said there were hundreds of people there. There were hundreds of people if you count city employees. We actually encountered about 72 people. That's a lot. And 22 of those people we were able to get into housing, 3 families into our tiny villages. And given that that's a difficult population, you know, those are better results, frankly, than I think we were expecting to get there.
You're saying
22
people?
22 of the 72 accepted offers of shelter.
So 51 didn't.
That's true. That's true. And that's still
on our property.
And that's still an issue we're working on. We had spaces for those folks. We have found in 2017, during the first year of the navigation team, the found it usually took us 4 contacts with an individual to get them to accept offers of shelter. So far in 2018, that's 6 contacts. So this is a repeat business where we have to keep working with people, finding the right solutions, finding the housing, and finding the kinds of services that might deal with mental health or addiction issues that people need to get them into a more stable place. And ultimately, that is going to be the solution. Otherwise, we are just kind of chasing people around and cleaning up after them. But that needs to be done also, I'm told. And really, you have great partners here in the police department and the parks department, which really led this effort here in Myers Way in terms of logistics. I'm told that through the first day, 2 days of the cleanup, we removed 190 tons of debris from that greenbelt. And so this is an enormous operation. And because we always need to have safe spaces and find shelter alternatives, that is what led to some of the scheduling and rescheduling of this, because logistics really, were kind of military in nature in terms of how this gets organized. But we also wanted to do it as late as possible in the season, because once winter starts, it's very hard to work there, so we didn't want an opportunity for the area to get recamped before and not have time, to do this as late as possible so we can get into the fall and winter weather as late as possible after the cleanup. I think there's some follow-up questions, but I did want to get to the question of, if you're trying to get a hold of us, you should maintain good relationships with the precinct, but you can always call the city's customer service bureau at 206-684-CITY. They will take these complaints. That is the quickest way to get a referral to us. And again, my name is Fred Podesta. Because we are just reorganizing things, I don't have business cards to give you, but I'm easy to find in the Human Services Department. Anybody here can contact me, and we can help work with the logistics and the schedule and understand the needs of this neighborhood. Through the first week of September, over the prior 6 weeks, our customer service line was averaging 440 complaints a week about encampment issues. So this is a very large problem. We're grateful that the mayor is adding resources to this issue, and we need to keep growing this, but we prioritize as best we can based on the risk for neighborhoods and the risk to people living outdoors, and we will continue to do our best.
Thank you so much.
To just talk about parks activation. And then also, I just want to say, please stay in communication. The letters from HPAC have been really helpful, very detailed. Your questions are... And keep those communications coming to me. I share them with my colleagues. We take the suggestions, the ideas, the questions very seriously. And we want to continue to hear from you.
One of the questions that was posed was, how are we going to keep people out of the area? I think that was part of your question about how.
Out of the area.
We're talking about Myers Way, the one we're just cleaning up.
Well, we are, but I'm just saying there's 600 vulnerable seniors that live directly across.
I understand. I can only speak to what our plans are for activating. So a portion of this. Property is owned by the city, a portion is owed by the state.
Oh, we're well aware.
And so what we plan on doing, as we did in East Duwamish, where we kept people out for a couple of years out of the East Duwamish, which is a area as large as Myers Way and even larger. And so we have what we call the Seattle Green Partnership, who restores our forest, our urban forest in the area. And they will work with contractors and volunteers. And we're trying to find volunteer stewards, and they will occupy about eight acres of restoration. We are also talking to the state, and we've sent them an estimate of what it would take us to restore their portion of the property as well. So we'll be there. It's our intent to be there to work for a few months to try to, to break the cycle of people coming back. Also, we will have to continue, and I haven't talked to Fred that much about this, we're going to continue to post and continue to be back regularly, at least for the next couple of months. I think we need to do that. And so anyway, we need to break the cycle. We have the same cycle, if you remember the jump up in the East Duwamish. But we did the same kind of process, and we broke the cycle. So we hope we can be successful here as well.
I hope that you have been able to get some useful information this evening. Thank you so much for coming to our September